Hello, I'm Dr. Colin Campbell. I'm a senior research scientist here at Meter Group and also adjunct faculty at Washington State University, where I teach a class in environmental biophysics. And today we're going to talk about absolute humidity. In a previous lecture, we talked about relative humidity and how relative humidity was a challenging variable to use in environmental studies. So I'm going to talk today about what might be the right variable to use as we talk about humidity. So absolute humidity can be either talked about in terms of vapor pressure, which I'm most used to, or some people talk about it in terms of vapor density. But whatever we use, we start usually by calculating this from a relative humidity value and a knowledge of air temperature. So from another lecture I gave talking about relative humidity, I said the HR, or the relative humidity, was equal to the vapor pressure divided by the saturation vapor pressure. And in most studies, most data coming from the field, we'd get a report of typically the air temperature and the relative humidity. So how do we take those values and turn them into something that we could use to compare different sites, or to calculate fluxes, or to calculate how much water is actually in the air? Well, we need to work through some of these other equations to get there, and I'm going to take you through it and give you an example so that you know how to do that calculation. So let's first talk about absolute humidity in terms of vapor pressure, or this EA. So EA, if we rearrange this equation here, very simple math here, the relative humidity times the saturation vapor pressure, that will give us our vapor pressure. And that vapor pressure is now an absolute humidity. How would we do this? Well, let me just talk about an example first in terms of vapor pressure. So let's say we got a weather report, and it said the air temperature was 25 degrees Celsius, and the relative humidity, HR, was 28% or 0.28. First, we'd use Teton's formula, which I talked about in another lecture. We'd say the saturation vapor pressure at the air temperature is equal to 0.611 kilopascals times the exponential of a constant times the air temperature divided by another constant plus the air temperature. So in our case, the air temperature right now is 25 degrees, so we'd put that in there. Remember, this is a function, saturation vapor pressure, a function of 25. So 0.611 kilopascals times the exponential of 17.502, in the other lecture that's what I showed you was that B value, times 25 degrees divided by the C value, 240.97, and then we add to that 25 degrees. Now this is for liquid water. Of course, it's 25 degrees Celsius, so nothing's frozen. If you were working over ice, these constants would be different, but of course we're not here. So we put this into our calculator, into a spreadsheet, and we easily calculate the saturation vapor pressure at 25 degrees C is 3.17 kilopascals. So we're not done yet. We have to go back to this equation I showed you just a minute ago that says the vapor pressure is equal to the relative humidity times the saturation vapor pressure. So when we plug our data in, that's here the relative humidity, 0.28. times the saturation vapor pressure that we calculated right here, and we get a vapor pressure of 0.89 kilopascals. And if we were calculating fluxes, we'll talk about that in another lecture, this is typically the value we would use. But there are other things we can do with these relative humidity values, or sorry, the absolute humidity values that might be useful. So let's talk about vapor density. If we had a certain volume of air and we wanted to know how much water was in that volume of air, for example, if we were going to try to condense it out, we'd more typically use this vapor density calculation, the value. So I want to know, how do I get from a vapor pressure that I can easily calculate from a weather report, something like that, to a vapor density that would allow me to talk about actually how much water was in the air? This is our equation here that says the vapor pressure times the molecular weight of water divided by the universal gas constant times the Kelvin temperature of the air will give us the vapor density. So I'll take you through an example here, just continue on the one we've already done, just so you can see how to calculate it and to avoid a pretty common misstep. So again, molecular weight of water is 18.02 grams per mole. The universal gas constant, R, is 8.31 joules per mole Kelvin. And here's the Kelvin temperature of the air. I've scribbled this in a little bit. That's how I note the difference between something like this, which would be air temperature in Celsius, and this air temperature in Kelvin. So let's go ahead and plug all these into our equation. So there's our vapor pressure just out right here. We're just dragging that over here, put it in there. There's our molecular weight of water. There's our universal gas constant. And here is the Kelvin temperature of the air. So as we look at this, you immediately see, oh, how do I cancel these units? The kilopascals and the joules are certainly not going to work out of that as they are. But luckily, there are some conversions we can use. A pascal is equal to a newton per meter squared, and a joule is equal to a newton meter. So if we put that in, so we change this joule to a newton meter, we change this pascal to a newton per meter squared, we have to pay attention here as we're doing it. That kilo right there, don't forget that, because that can mess you up. So I'm circling that to make sure that we've got this. Now we cancel our newtons there. The meter square here in the denominator and this meter in the denominator makes a meter cubed. You can see that. That's what we're hoping for on the bottom. The grams come out on top. They don't cancel, but everything else does. The moles cancel moles here. The Kelvin cancels the Kelvin there. And the newton cancels the newton. And we come out with just what we were looking for, save one thing, which is a kilograms per meter cubed. And this calculation gives us 0.0065. But since we actually wanted to do this in grams, because that's more typical of what you find in how much water there is in air, it's not in a kilogram of water, but more is in terms of grams of water, we get 6.5 grams per meter cubed. And one way you can check this calculation if you were actually doing it is just as a rule of thumb, if we had pressure of the air of 100 kilopascals, so just the air pressure, and a temperature of 20 degrees Celsius, the multiplier to get from your vapor pressure to your vapor density is about 7.4 or so. So let's say, we'll just say around 7, and we'll just do a quick mental calculation, 0.89 times 7, that should give us something around 6, and our answer should be around 6, and it is. It's certainly no orders of magnitude off that. So we've got the right answer, and or at least close to the right answer, just doing a check, and we can say this conversion worked. So if you want to learn more about instrumentation to measure all kinds of atmospheric parameters, please come to our website, www.metergroup.com, or you can email me, chat more about this, colin.campbell@metergroup.com. Thanks.